In May 2006, John Basil Utley relived a painful but enlightening moment in his life while viewing the exhibition on the Russian Gulag at Ellis Island. It took him back to the period of Stalin's great terror, when few were spared the ominous fear, paranoia, imprisonment, hard labor, and even death. The experiences of John's father, Arkady Berdyshevsky, serve as a microcosm of this all-engulfing terror, while the son's search to learn of his father's fate brought him to the labor camps in the Siberian tundra. In 1934, John Utley was born in Moscow to Frida Utley, a British intellectual, and Arkady Berdyshevsky, a Russian diplomat and an employee of the Arcos trade mission of the Russian government. John's mother, Frida, was a well-known author, scholar, and trade union leader.
My mother and father were both very activist people. My mother was well-educated. Then her father died at 16. She went to work as a clerk during the First World War in the offices in London. And she became active in the labor union movement and was the secretary of her labor union of women clerks and a title like that. And then was active in the Socialist Party. Later she was at London University and was the chairman of the Socialist Party at London University, and had written and was better and better known. And she met my father, who was with the Russian trade delegation, and they fell in love, and that was in 1927. She was invited to Russia with the British labor union leaders. And that was a time of the new economic policy, it's called, when Lenin had allowed private enterprise to flower. And Russia looked very good then. There was abundance of food, people were healthy, there was new construction, everything, the economy looked very good in Russia, while England was in very bad straits in the 1920s. And so it looked like communism worked.
Frida's later works would, however, reflect quite negatively on the communist system. In Lost Illusions, Final Chapters, she recounts her family's own harrowing experience with Stalin's Soviet Union. She writes, "I wish I had immediately joined the goodly company which tried to save the world from the consequences of a false belief in communism and Russian intentions. Against the tragedy of the Second World War and its aftermath, my own personal tragedy is insignificant. That in itself helped me to make the decision to speak out boldly about Soviet Russia, whatever consequences to Arkady, if he still lives." On April 10th, 1936, at 2 o'clock in the morning, there was a knock at the door of Arkady and Frida's small Moscow apartment. Russian secret police officers entered the apartment. After several hours of methodical searching through papers and belongings, the officers arrested Arkady. Neither Frida nor 2-year-old John would ever see him again.
Well, he had been arrested in Moscow, where he lived. The police had been investigating his boss. My father was the what would today be called chief financial officer of a group called Promexport, was the government import-export organization, a very large group. And they were investigating for some exports that should not have been done. And the police picked up my father, but it was once the police got somebody, they started looking for something they'd done. And my father had lived overseas many years, in England, in America, even in Japan with the Russian embassy. And it was a time when Stalin was really starting to liquidate most Russians who knew about the outside world.
Immediately following his arrest, He was interrogated at the infamous Lubyanka prison, where he was accused of subversive Trotskyist activities and sentenced to imprisonment in the Gulag.
We believe that as many as 18 million people were imprisoned in the Gulag over several decades. It really was instituted right after the revolution when political prisoners were arrested and sent to the far, far east of the country, to the Solovyetsky Islands. It took on massive scales already in 1929, 1930, after Stalin consolidated power and became the dictator of the country, a position he held until his death in 1953. So it was an extraordinary quarter century of violence and persecution. And the fact that it engulfed whole categories of people, not only the obvious political opponents of the regime within the communist movement or political movements per se, but religious believers, writers, people who are accused of undermining the economy, people accused of subversion of different types, often falsely accused, of course. And so this was not only a form of intimidation of the population, which I think was its primary purpose, but it also reflected a certain paranoia on the part of Stalin, that if he knew there were certain obvious opponents in a city or in a community, he would arrest 100 to make sure he got those 3 people.
The appearance of legality was terribly important to the Russian state. There were trials held, even if they were 1-minute trials or 30-second trials. Every prisoner had a trial and every prisoner was sentenced. Almost every, I should say, that there were some who, in moments of chaos, didn't get them. But this was part of the way in which the Gulag was justified to the people who were charged with carrying it out, who were charged with keeping the prisons and organizing them. Every guard, it was told to him that these prisoners are criminals, they've had a trial, they're enemies of the people, it's been proved. The legalistic aspect was both for the guards and the administrators, and it was also for the greater population. The greater public was also told constantly that, okay, we have these prisons, but they are for enemies, for criminals. It was a way of maintaining the system, you know, and sort of saving face within the Soviet system. You know, we're not a criminal state. We're a legalistic state, and you know, these people are you know, legal prisoners, legal captives.
After his arrest, Frieda tried in vain for several weeks to see him or learn what he had been accused of. Because she had a British passport, she was able to obtain an exit visa for herself and young John. Once in London, Frieda continued to search for information about Arkady. The British intellectual leftist community tried to come to her aid.
She suspected that he died eventually. But again, some very influential people wrote on her behalf. There were people like Bernard Shaw, the famous playwright, universally known, Bertrand Russell, the famous British philosopher. There were strong letters addressed personally to Stalin. No reply was ever registered.
In 1967, after years of trying, Frieda learned, after a request for information from former U.S. Ambassador to Russia, Llewellyn Thompson, simply that Arkady had died in northern Russia in 1938 in the state of Komi. After the fall of the Soviet Union in the 1990s, more information began to leak out. John became hopeful that he could now learn more about his father's fate.
The main point was getting the documents, and I had heard that people could find today the documents of the trials and records of their parents in the camps. But you needed someone, obviously Russian-speaking, to do that, which a friend of mine, George Krasnow, wrote to the KGB.
After defecting to the West, I came to the United States, became a U.S. citizen, and was professor at several universities in the United States, and I'm mostly teaching about Sovietology, about dissidents. And so after the collapse of the Soviet system, I decided to move to Washington, D.C., and I befriended John, and naturally, having learned that his father perished somewhere in the Gulag, I felt empathy with him. I call him, he's an American, but he's also our Soviet orphan, because he grew up without father. And I, little by little, started to suggest to him, trying to encourage him, John, why don't you find out about the fate of your father? Because I knew that it was heavy upon his heart. And finally, he agreed that we should try. First, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, still there was suspicion that the same guys are running FSB as the KGB, so therefore he was not so hopeful in the beginning. At the turn of the millennium, I guess, I made first trip to find out how to approach searching for the dossier of his father, and it's not easy because the system is still rather bureaucratic. Finally, I was able to find out that the file on his father exists, where we can obtain more complete information. But 2004, finally, I had access to the library of FSB, that successor agency to KGB, and I went there. And finally, of course, the document was of great relevance for that. Actually, John's father has been rehabilitated. That means his sentence was null and void. But again, this dossier did not contain the evidence of his future fate once Mr. Berdichevsky was sent to 5-year sentence somewhere in Komi Republic. So that's what we knew. But we wanted to find for sure what happened to his father.
The inheritors of the KGB, the secret police, were very helpful, and they gave us pictures, better than any picture my mother had, from the files. They'd been there for 60 years. With those documents, we were told to write to Uchta, another provincial concentration camp administrative capital in the state of Komi, which is the north of Russia.
The Komi Republic in northern Russia is a large region the size of France. It lies within the Arctic Circle.
At the time, the Komi Republic was chosen by the Soviet government as one of the principal regions where the camps were to be located. This is first of all because it is a huge territory, more than 600,000 square kilometers, and it is sparsely settled. In the 30s, the population totaled not more than 300,000 people, and this territory is very rich in natural resources. There is timber here, there is coal, oil, natural gas here, but there are no roads and no major cities. And it was decided that the populating of the territory was to be accomplished through the work of prisoners.
И было решено начать освоение этой территории силами заключенных.
Upon arriving in Russia, there was much doubt as to whether John could ever learn his father's fate. In order to continue the search for information, John and his friend George had to travel deep into austere regions of northern Russia.
I am Evgenia Zerinskaya, the chair of the Ukhto Pekosh Organization Memorial. We are here in the city of Ukhta. The city of Ukhta is the capital of Gulag Komi. This is where the Gulag began. From here, scores of prisoners were sent to Vorkuta, to Umta, to the Bebosh region. The center of it all was here until 1938. As far as I know, our Ukhta archive had over 1 million note cards on prisoners. These are not complete files. These are note cards. There were fewer complete records. I came to Memorial and subsequently became its director, because the history of our city could not have happened without the labor of the prisoners. The prisoners created all of the industry of the city, in our region, in our republic, and of course, our main industries are coal and gas. Those are our high priority industries.
Это у нас нефть, газ, это приоритеты наши.
I don't know who came here from America before I took over Memorial, but since 2001, John Utley is the only American who came here and searched for his father.
Который приехал сюда и разыскивал могилу своего отца.
It was here, while investigating the meticulous files, that John finally discovered his father's ultimate fate.
I'm here now in a city called Ukhta in the state of Komi in northern Russia. This building is where I was shown the documents of my father's history in the camps. It included a 5x7 card showing and ending with the showing transfer to the third department, which meant execution in the language of the secret police.
After being sentenced to a corrective labor camp, as they called concentration camps or labor camps in Russia, and while serving there, his father was presumably involved in a hunger strike and other, what they call, counter-revolutionary Trotskyite activities. And so, therefore, he was sentenced by Troika, three men in charge, and they quickly, without much evidence, sentenced almost everyone to the highest degree of punishment, as they call it. That means death by execution.
It's a sort of peaceful thing, you know, to know what happened, because my mother never knew. She only got two or three postcards from him and never knew if when he died, where he was sent, like all the families of these victims. There was never an official reason for his arrest given to her, etc. So she died without knowing what had happened to him. And it's amazing they have all these files. But from that, we learned which camp my father had been in, and that actually, instead of dying of hunger and labor and freezing, as my mother had thought, he had been executed, and that he had been one of three leaders of a hunger strike in the camps.
While traveling through Komi, John met Mikhail Rogachev in Syktyvkar, who was in charge of a project to catalog information about all the prisoners killed in Komi.
These are books of remembrances of the victims of Stalin's purges. Our task is to try to reconstruct the names of all the people who were put into exile for special resettlement in the territory of what is now the Komi Republic. How did all of this begin? There was a need to restore the names of these people. We didn't quite know how to do it at first. The archives were sealed. Then gradually we started to get access to the archives. Slowly, the names started to appear. Then at the end of the 90s, we began to receive government support.
In one of his books, Rogachev pointed out Arkady's entry in the historical log.
John, I would like to show you the seventh volume published by us. Right here, take a look. These are the lists of prisoners of the camps from Stalin's time. And among them, you will find a familiar surname. This is your father right here. Berdyshevsky, Arkady Yakovlevich, born in the year 1888, Jew, born in Odessa, a prisoner of the Ukhta Pekorsh camp of the NKVD. Economist, worked in the mineshaft called Capital. Arrested on the 27th of December, 1937. Convicted on the 11th of January, 1938, by a trio of the NKVD of the Arkhangelsk region under Chapter 58-10-11, that is, anti-Soviet agitation and propaganda, and sentenced to the highest level of punishment, the death penalty. Your father was executed by firing squad on the 30th of March, 1938, in Vorkuta.
So it became more and more interesting to track what had actually happened. And we got, and we're finally to Vorkuta.
With the information he gathered in Ukhta, John made his final stop in Vorkuta, a coal mining town deep into the Arctic Circle.
Воркута была самым крупным, и поэтому говорят, что самый зловещий островок ГУЛАГа.
Воркута was the largest, and it was said to be the most ominous. See, you've come here to film in the summer, but you know they say that in Воркута, in the polar north, 12 months of the year they have winter, and the rest is summer. So there is practically no summer, just winter, 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 and the conditions here are very harsh. In the coal mines, conditions were extremely tough. And in the years of the war, even women worked in the mine shafts. Children worked in the mine shafts. So everyone says that the fatality rate here was really high. But you know, the fatality rate was very high everywhere in the beginning, when the gulags were first being established. And another reason the fatality rate was so very high was because many people were executed. It is always very pleasant when our work, which sometimes seems to us to be useless, is suddenly in demand. Many people have been coming to visit from all over. It began when we first published these martyr logs and the lists, and people come to us and we give them answers. And of course, the fact that John Utley came all this way at his age, this is a great joy for us. We are very glad that this arouses interest, and that there are relatives who do not forget their ancestors. This is the most important thing, that a generation is not being forgotten, and that there is a connection between the generations, and that people think about this. This is very pleasant when people come to visit, and it is very important to us that John Utley and his children can know about this. If his children know, then maybe this will never be repeated.
There, the local office of Memorial, which is a group of Russians who follow these issues and try to help people find the past records and works for civil rights and human rights today in Russia, I might add, the office there were volunteers helped us, and we discovered that he had been executed at a place called a brick quarry.
The local Memorial officials had recently found the location of the brick quarry and agreed to take John on foot onto the tundra to visit the ruins of the execution site.
It's a very desolate site, the tundra. Desolate, but impressive. And people were taken out. We learn now the stories. Men gathered there, about 2,000 men, may have been more, and were taken out by the executioners in groups of 40 men, taken out a few hundred yards from the site and machine gunned to death. And in fact, first they had to take off their coats and much of their clothing and even shoes. And this is in April, when there was snow on the ground. And of course, the other prisoners could hear the shooting going on. It was absolute horror.
During most of the year, the brutal tundra is unforgiving. Temperatures can reach negative 40 degrees, with fierce Arctic winds blowing down the tundra from the ocean.
By 1937, the brick factory was no longer operational, and it was converted into a concentration camp. The barracks were reinforced, more bars were put up, and it was surrounded by barbed wire. There was not enough room, so they put up some additional tents. People didn't work in them, but simply awaited their fate. To carry out order number 00409, a lieutenant of public safety was sent here. Kashkaden, Heimmeyer, Skomorovsky. His assignment was to investigate and to convict the people housed here of a capital offense. They had already been sentenced as Trotskyites, counter-revolutionaries, but he was here to find a way to have them executed. So he conducted his investigation, and when that phase of the operation was finished, at the beginning of 1937, they started the executions. Initially, they were individual executions, well, 5 or 10 people, not mass executions. The first mass execution was carried out here on the 1st of March, 1938, after the completion of the investigation. The shootings continued after this at intervals of 10 or 15 days. But by the 30th of March, I guess they had gotten good at it. And in one day, 351 people were killed. Among their number, the father of John Utley, Arkady Berdyshevsky.
I'm here in northern Russia. We are about 150 miles from the Arctic Ocean. And this is where my father was executed in 1938, an inmate of a concentration camp in the town of Vorkuta. Coming here and finding where my father died, that was something I always wondered what he would have been thinking about and what he was looking at. What the surroundings were, this land. And I always, of course, thought what was in his mind when he died. For me, it's a wonderful opportunity and a great gift that I am able to come here to see this before I die. And I think to myself, would my father ever have imagined that his son one day would come here? And of course, I can't. He must have thought it was all hopeless, and he surely would have thought that I would have died because my mother was English, my father Russian. Because my mother was English and had me on her passport, she was able to get me out of Russia. And so he would never have known that she could escape from Russia and get me out in those years in 1936 when he was arrested. So for me, it's a sense of peace afterwards. You've been here and one sort of, there's a continuity, if you will.
Well, I think the lesson for me is that every society has these people, the communist and the Nazi type of killers and secret police, and they exist in all societies, and one values America more above all the freedom of speech and property rights, etc. That it's unlikely to happen to us, but I think my thing is to be aware that it could even happen to us, the paranoia now about terrorism. In my mother's book, there's a point that human beings are not so different. And she makes some comment, more or less, that the difference between being a prisoner and being a guard, it's within all of us to be those things. And this is the kind of totalitarian system. Perhaps we've forgotten the horrors of these things, but that's what can evolve and hopefully will not ever again.
John was one of the lucky family members who learned about his father's destiny. The lives of the other victims of Stalin lay in the historical abyss, buried under rock and snow, less than a footnote in the annals of history.